morning. He is risen. Indeed he has. I think I enjoyed watching your response to our next series promo as much as I did watching it. Some of you have a little rhythm going on with your foot when they were doing and trying to get up there and dance. I will teach you those dance moves that I taught the choreography a little later on. And if you believe that, April Fools. What a weird day to have Easter on April Fool's Day, you know? But actually, there was a little April Fool's going on. Satan thought he had Jesus in the tomb all stacked up and all behind a big stone and never to see him again. And April Fool's, Jesus is risen. Amen. A little slow on the uptake on that, but we'll practice again later on. This morning, we really want to talk to you about how we can find hope in some unexpected places. Jesus, being the unexpected difference maker that he is, visits us in situations and areas in our life where we just don't feel like we have any hope at times within our life. And hope seems far, far away, and the future doesn't seem very bright whatsoever. I don't know about you, when I was growing up, I loved sports. I mean, loved to attempt to play sports. There was a suggestion earlier that I show some of my early day sports pictures, but I'm not going to do that. One knee pad when you're playing basketball just doesn't look as cool as it did back in a long time ago. But I would practice over and over again because I always wanted to be a part of a comeback. If you've ever played sports, you want to be a part of a comeback victory. Is that right, guys? If you've ever played sport? Yeah. And I used to practice outside all the time. We had a bunch of guys in my neighborhood. There's like 8 guys in my neighborhood. And so if it was fall, we played football in these yards. We had like 3 yards that went together, and so it formed a football field. If it was in the spring or summer, we played baseball. If it was in the wintertime, we played basketball. So some guys are wrestlers, but we dragged them out on the basketball court anyway. Made going to the goal a whole lot tougher when you go in and they pin you to the cement, you know, things like that. But we kept our own stats, you know, and we competed like crazy. It was a lot of fun. It was huge fun. But the thing is we always wanted to hit that game-winning home run or make the stop that stopped the comeback attempt. And I would set up chairs on my driveway at home, and I would practice driving with my left hand, rubbing off an imaginary defender and pulling up and popping the jump shot that would win the game, or slipping the pass to my center who was breaking to the goal, or something of that nature, just to practice over and over because sometime I wanted to have that big comeback win. Finally, when I was in high school, I had that opportunity. We were playing in a tournament up in Moore, Oklahoma, and I drove to my left, went around, and 6'9" Alvin Adams blocked my shot into the third row of bleachers. Wasn't much of a comeback except, and that grief that follows not being able to win that win or complete that comeback sometimes just overwhelms us at times within our lives. But we like comeback wins, right? 2 years ago, Clemson beats the Crimson Tide of Alabama in the last second to be able to win the NCAA championship in football. That same year in the Super Bowl, New England's down 28-3, and they can make this huge comeback and win in the fourth quarter to beat the Atlanta Falcons. That same year also, the Cubbies, the Chicago Cubs, who have forever been able to snatch defeat from the jaws of victory, you know, win in the 7th game of the World Series in extra innings, and they pull off the World Series win. How many of you watched the NCAA basketball tournament so far this year? Okay, how many of you's bracket were just completely broken the first week? Yeah, mine was too. No comeback hope for that whatsoever. But we have had a team until last night anyway, Loyola of Chicago, who was 11th seed, and they had comeback after comeback. The first game, in the last second of the game, one of their players hit a jump shot to be able to win that game. In the second game in the tournament, another guy pulls up from a three and hits it when they were down 1 point, and they end up winning the game. In the third game of the tournament, also 6 seconds left, a guy hits a three-pointer to be able to complete this comeback, and they win again. Just a Cinderella story all the way through. We like comeback people. We didn't think Loyola had a chance at all of making the Final Four. They made it, and lots of people were rooting for them last night, but April Fools, it didn't happen, and it was cut short. You know, that happens from time to time within our lives. One of the things about comebacks is that we always want them in our life. And there are those of you who this morning have hope that there's going to be a comeback in your life. There's an area in your life where you do not feel like there's any hope whatsoever. It's just stagnant. You've wished, you've prayed, you've hoped, and yet there seems to be still this fear, this grief, this dark shadow that overcomes you because you wonder, how in the world am I ever going to make a comeback in this area? How am I going to be able to get a win? Where's the wind in the midst of the depth of your darkness? So where do you need a comeback this morning? Where do you need a victory in this morning? Where's your hope flagging this morning and you're wishing, I wish God somehow would interrupt my darkness in order to help me to find hope? What is that area in your life? I'm just going to pause for a second because I think the common denominator in comebacks is this whole time of hoping that there is an opportunity that there's a comeback possible. Now, when Jesus died on Good Friday, that first Good Friday, everybody around him, nobody expected a comeback. They all thought this was it. Their hope had died with him. And they felt hopeless. They never, even though Jesus talked about the resurrection over and over again, it wasn't real to them. They didn't really trust that that was true within their life. And this morning we're going to go to John chapter 20 and look at two different instances in which it describes kind of the disciples, the followers of Jesus, of how they felt hopeless in the situation. They wanted hope, but they just couldn't find it at all. How many of you ever heard the song, Looking for Love in All the Wrong Places? All right? You're saying, is he going country and western on us this morning? No. But we're going to look for hope in some unexpected places this morning, all right? Ka-ching segue there, okay? Circumstances that in our life just that look totally hopeless for us. And what I want you to see this morning is that Jesus can come into your life in areas that you feel like are just totally hopeless, and he is the unexpected difference maker in the realm of hope. If you brought a Bible with you this morning, I'd love for you to open it, or if you have an app on your phone, if you don't have that, look on the screens here in just a moment. We're going to go to John chapter 20. John is the fourth biography of Jesus, the first four books of the New Testament. Matthew, who was one of the 12 apostles, and then the second one was written by Mark, who was a traveling companion of both Paul and Peter. And then the third one was Luke, who was a traveling companion of Paul. And then the fourth one was John, another one of the 12 disciples. And he gives a very full account about the events after Jesus' crucifixion. And so in his 20th chapter of his biography, he says this: early on the first day of the week. What day would that be? What day would it be? Sunday. That's right. First day of the week, Sunday. We're celebrating that today. While it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. Mary arrives, and she was expecting to be able to have to struggle or get somebody to help her to move that stone, and it's already been moved. It's been rolled uphill. The seal has been broken on it, and now she was grieving to begin with, but now she's really upset. She's really grieving over the whole situation. Verse 11, if you want go down to it, it says, now Mary stood outside the tomb doing what? Crying. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and one at the foot. Go ahead. They asked her, woman, why are you crying? Let me just have a little hand raise from the men for just a second. How many of you have ever asked your wife, why are you crying? Can I see your hand? I won't ask you to tell me the reply you got, because I have asked that question way too many often, too often. I've been married 44 years now, and I still haven't learned that when my wife cries that I should not say, honey, why are you crying? You know, because the backlash comes on. I know that angels aren't supposed to be both are genderless, but I think these are two men angels. That's the only thing I can put on it. I say, why are you crying? They've taken my Lord away, she said, and I don't know where they've put him. At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. And then here's Jesus. He asked her, woman, why are you crying? He's the Son of God. Come on, Jesus. It just shows you that all men are clueless. Amen, guys? Can I get an amen on that? Yeah, we are clueless. All right. We've admitted it, women. You can have a good day the rest of the day. Thinking he was the gardener, she said, sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him, and I'll go get him. Can you catch the sadness in her voice? Can you catch the grief that's there? Grief has robbed her of all hope. Jesus has said to this Mary, this person Mary, this is not Mary, the mother of Jesus. He has said to her, he's talked to her. He gave her a special lesson on the resurrection. But at the time of death, the time of the loss of a significant person within her life, she is grieving and she cannot see any hope whatsoever. Fear has robbed her of grief within her life. Grief has robbed her of that situation of where she has any trust at all in the resurrection. I think that's true in your life. It's been true in my life. There's been times when I've lost a significant person in my life, and there's just this feeling of darkness. There's this feeling of being in the shadow. Anybody else felt that? You just everything just kind of closes in around you, and you feel like there's no hope. Grief robs us of the hope of the future. And it's interesting to me that oftentimes, and including myself when I have felt that way, that I have stopped trusting in the fact of the reality of the resurrection. Now, I don't mean to be critical to anybody here this morning who's in the midst of grief, but the reality is oftentimes our grief sinks us because we no longer trust in the reality that there's something beyond the grave, that Jesus has conquered the grave, and there's something beyond that. And really, it's just echoes of a very powerful philosophy that invades mankind. It's been around for a long time. We call it today the God is dead philosophy, but it's really an echo of a guy by the name of Friedrich Nietzsche, who in the 19th century, the late 1800s, kind of begin to write about this whole idea that there's nothing beyond this world whatsoever. There's, once you die, that's it. There's nothing supernatural. There's no supernatural things that can occur. And really, it came into Nietzsche's life after the loss of his mom. Biographers of Nietzsche would say that his whole world changed after his mother died, and he became inconsolable in his grief. And because of that, he began to write different things about that there is no God. And he didn't want there to be God. He didn't want there to be anything that says that there's anything after that death time. Partly for his own morality, he didn't want that. But for Nietzsche, this whole idea was a tragedy. He describes it very parabolically in a parable that he wrote about the madman. He has the madman coming into the marketplace, and people who are surrounding there, none of them believe in God. All of them believe that God is dead. And he has a lantern with him, and he throws the lantern down, and he begins to scream, and he says, who has killed our God? Let me tell you who's killed our God. You have. And for Nietzsche, 19th century science and this whole idea of his loss of his mom meant that there was no God for him. Grief had robbed him of any hope of the future. And the people around him begin to jeering, and they said, did your God get lost? Perhaps he's on a journey. You know, maybe he's hiding someplace. Where is your God? And they begin to beat on him and jeer him and laugh at him. And the madman jumps up, and he pushes them all away, and he says, where's God? I'll tell you. You've killed him. You are his murderers. And for Nietzsche, it was a tragedy that God was dead in some ways. He understood the idea of what that philosophy is. He says, you are his murderers. Who gave you the sponge to wipe away the horizon? Who gave you the right to say there's no longer an up or down? Has not the universe become colder? If God is dead, then night is continually closing in on us all around us. And the crowd became silent. The madman walks away, just stalks away. Now, Nietzsche was a genius, but he died in darkness, and his rage against God left our world in darkness. And as we experience the despair of behaving and believing as if there is no God, that he is that he is dead, that there's no miracles, no resurrection. Now, while he was the one whose philosophy of God is dead begin to grow and spawn generations of there is nothing outside of ourselves, but at least he understood the significance of where that would lead the world, in despair and darkness with no hope. Where there's no hope, there becomes fear in its place. Many people, many of you sitting here this morning, feel like that philosophy has no place, that it has no power. You can't read history and believe that. Martin Luther in 1517 proclaimed very, very strongly in Germany by tacking up 95 theses on the doorway of a church that salvation was the result not of any works that we do, but it's based upon faith, the trust that Jesus Christ died for us and his resurrection is true. His powerful proclamation of that philosophy, that idea, that reality, changed Germany for the next 300 years. Germany's whole atmosphere changed. Nietzsche comes along in the late 1800s and he said, no, God is dead. You've got to pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. You yourself are the power. Das Superman, the Superman, that's the only hope there is for society. Now, at first, Germany didn't believe him, but along came a guy by the name of Adolf Hitler. And he put Nietzsche's philosophies into practice. And the result was just a whole nation, the Jewish nation, was almost totally destroyed because they were the ones going to be in power. Nietzsche's philosophies had horrible results because it was based on the fact that you can't trust God, you can't trust the resurrection at all. Individual perspective, he said, is what's important. He says this, let me read this to you. Nietzsche himself rejected the idea of any objective reality. He claimed the death of God would eventually lead to the loss of any universal perspective on things and the coherent sense of objective truth. In other words, it's only based upon what you think. You become your own authority. That's where we live today. That's the issue with the fact that people feel like there's no hope today because I'm my own authority. There is no objective reality. There's no universal truth anywhere in society. And so what that leaves us with is just chaos within our lives. And it leads us to fear. And fear robs us of hope. You've experienced it. You've experienced loss. You've experienced the loss of a loved one, someone significant. And what follows, if you're not careful, is fear. You get afraid of everything. You don't want to go outside your house. You don't want to interact with other people. And in the absence of hope, there's paralyzing fear. In John 20, verse 19, after the crucifixion, it says that the disciples were gathered together. They went back to the upper room where they celebrated the Last Supper. And they just closed themselves in there, locked the doors. Why? Because they knew that the Romans, or even the Jews, knew that they were associated with the person that they just crucified, Jesus. And so thousands of people would be hunting for them, looking for them, trying to kill them. And so fear paralyzes them, and they huddle together in that upper room, afraid of anyone at all that would come into them. Behind the locked doors, their fear just grew and grew and grew and grew. One thing that's true for all of us is that we all have fear, right? I don't know about you, but we don't often like to talk about them. But there are over 700 different medical names of fears. Sometimes our fears are a little irrational. I grew up in an old two-story house. I guess I haven't left that type of house because I've got an old two-story house now. But in my room when I was growing up, I had a corner room in the upstairs, and I had 8 floor-to-ceiling windows, and my bed was in the corner of that. And at night, my neighbor had a tall, tall elm tree that the street light in the alley would shine through, and it would shine on my closet door behind me, and I would be in bed, and I'd look up, and I could see fingers coming out my closet door. And it was trying to get me. Now, I knew that if I could close that door, whoever was inside wouldn't get out. But if I got out of bed, the guy under the bed would grab me, right? Been there? And I would just stay in my bed, and I'd pull the covers over my bed, and every once in a while I'd look at it. And when it was lightning, oh my gosh, it was worse. You know, because then you just see the fingers, and see the fingers, see the fingers, see the fingers. And I pull my covers over my head. I don't know what, I must have been 20 years old or something like that, but it was right after I got married. No. But I'd be terrified, and I'd yell out, "Mom, Dad, help me!" And before long, I hear the footsteps of my dad coming up the stairs. I guess they drew straws, and he always lost. And he would come up, and he'd say, "Why are you crying?" See, my dad, my mom wouldn't have said that. She already knew. She'd say, "Why are you crying? Why are you screaming?" And I'd say, "There's somebody in my closet." And Dad would shake his head slightly and go over the closet, and he'd open the door, and he'd say, "There's no one in here. How about under the bed?" He'd look under the bed. "There's no one here. You can go to sleep." And I could relax then. After he looked, there's nothing there. So there was a way of calming me down. We all have these fears. 700 different medical names for fears, and they all plague us. And it's always a result of our not being able to trust that God can take care of us in that situation. And we fear is a legitimate thing. God gave it to us, the desire to, and it's probably one of our strongest instincts in life, fight or flight. You know, fear or stand up to the situation. The basic drive that God gave all of us was to be able to survive. And so we are most fearful when we're in a position where we cannot control what's going to happen next. And in your life today, some of you have been robbed of resurrection power in your life by fear, because you have surrendered to that fear to where it is controlling every aspect of your life. You don't know what to do. Most of us know what it's like to be in that situation where there's something that's about ready to happen to you. You can see it coming, but it's beyond your power or beyond your ability to be able to do anything about it. Maybe a health scare, and you can't fix it. You want to try, and you've tried this drug, and you've tried that drug, and you've tried this therapy and that therapy, but nothing seems to fix it. And there's this fear, there's this anxiety because you can't do anything about it. Or it's the spouse who says, "I don't love you anymore." And you feel so desperate to be able to try to control their feelings, make them love you, make them feel a certain way about you, make them act a certain way about you, but you can't control that. Jesus always meets us in the place of our loneliness and fears. And in that passage we read just earlier in John 20, Jesus walked through that locked door, and he stood in the midst of his disciples, and he said, "Peace. Peace be with you." And if you're in a place where you have fear and anxiety that's overwhelming you, this is what he says. It's from 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7, which he says this: "Cast all your anxieties on the Lord, because he cares for you." It's not that somebody doesn't care. You've lost that sense of control, and you have to realize, I'm going to have to trust somebody outside of me. And if you're in a place of grief this morning, if you're in a place of fear, Jesus wants to express that care and concern for you on this Easter morning, just like he did for Mary on that Easter, just like he did for the disciples. And when he comes, he wants to know why you're crying. He wants you to know he cares, that you're not just surrounded by constant reminders of loss, of betrayal, of you trying to process the latest health setback or something like that. He wants you to find hope. And friends, can I just tell you, the resurrection gives unexpected hope in the midst of grief and in the midst of fear. It's not that we don't grieve. If you're a follower of Jesus, you just grieve differently. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 says this: "For we do not grieve as though who have no what?" No what? No hope. That's not the way we grieve. If you see, if you're a Christ follower, we have something to look forward to. This life is temporary. You know, this life is just a portion of things. We live forever in heaven ahead of us. We've had a number of deaths recently here in our congregation. Just, it seems like in the last, 4 or 5 weeks, we've just had more than I can remember in a long time within our congregation. first 6 months I was here, we had 27 deaths within our congregation during that time. But we've had a lot here recently. And some have been expected after a long illness. Some have been unexpected. But whether it's expected or unexpected, the shock of it still brings sadness and grief into our lives, right? My mom had Alzheimer's for several years. And I watched her just deteriorate away. It was one of the hardest times in my life to watch a woman who is very vibrant, very active, so sharp in her life, most of her life, to just sink into nothingness. Couldn't express herself. You could see her in the beginning trying so hard to be able to recall things, and she would not be able to do it. It just killed me at times. We moved her here to Muskogee. We were not able to keep her in our house, and so there was an Alzheimer's unit in one of the local nursing homes here, and so she stayed there, and I went by every day and just tried to get her to eat because she forgot how to eat. Finally, my oldest daughter would come with me, and for some reason, she would obey Tara. And I obey Tara today, but during that time, Mom would eat for her. But it just killed me. And there are times that I pray, God, I know there's more ahead. It's all right. I'd be willing to let her go home. My dad, on the other hand, after my mom died, was in great health. He had been down here over the holidays. He loved pecans. He picked a 30-gallon trash can full of pecans from our four pecan trees in our yard, went back home to shell them all out. That's what I like best about Dad. He shelled them out for me. And he took them home the day before the year turned 2000. He went to the post office to get his mail, as he always did. Came back home, sat down in his chair, and had a heart attack right in his chair. Two different ways of dying. One, you wanted death in some ways. If you're a follower, death's not the worst thing. The other was totally surprising. Both brought grieving to my life. But I didn't have to grieve without hope, because I knew that there was something more for them, that this life was not all that they had to experience. This life came to an ending, but there was things that came even more beyond that. And I'll tell you, because of the resurrection, you and I can grieve with hope. It's we don't have to stay in that darkness. We don't have to stay in the shadow of the cross or the shadow of the resurrection. You can grieve with hope. Fantley Killebrew, who is a member of our church, just passed away here a couple of weeks ago, and sudden illness. I mean, he did not even know he had cancer. Was doing great, and all of a sudden he started having problems in his side, a sharp pain. He was went to the hospital, and he just deteriorated quickly. Three or four weeks from the time of diagnosis till he died. Our elders gathered around him. He asked us to pray for him. And so we anointed him with oil, and we prayed for him. And interesting what he said. He said, I'm not worried. If I'm healed, I get to see my family for a few more years. If I die, I get to go home to be with Jesus. And I'll see him even sooner. And Fantley said, either way, I win. It's a win-win deal for me. Isn't that great words? Fantley's win came sooner than later. Hope shows up in grief because of the resurrection. And there are a lot of things in this life, friends, that are overrated. Lots of things that are overrated. But hope is not one of those things. Hope is not overrated. Hope is what gives us the ability to make it through. And if you're in a tunnel of discouragement this morning, hope can flood that tunnel and just knock out the end of it so it becomes a passageway to the other side. And when you're lost in a state of confusion, hope is the thing that can take the edge off panic. And when you're standing by a freshly dug grave, someone you deeply love, hope will soothe your grief and point you towards heaven, something that's more than just what this life experiences. Cemeteries are interesting places, right? There's markers all over the place marking nothing, really, because the person that's there is not there anymore that it marks. None of the people whose names are on those tombstones are really there. I love reading this. I know you're going to say, James, you're really weird, but most of you already know that anyway. I like reading epitaphs on tombstones. I don't know whether you do. I collect them. I write them down. And there's one in Wetumpka, Alabama, that says this. It's a guy by the name of Solomon Pease. And it says, you know, here lies Solomon Pease. Pease is not here, only the pod. Pease, shelled out, went home to God. Isn't that great? Let's applaud that one. That's a good one. All right, that's hope. That's hope. That's hope. When I visit the gravesides of my parents, they're in a mausoleum. My mom really did not like that. She was afraid of tornadoes to begin with, and she says, "What if a tornado hits that and my body's flying all through the cemetery?" You know, so irrational, but that's the fears we get. But I don't know what it is that I don't like visiting about that grave, you know. But I realized it not long ago. It's got my name on it, McCracken, right there. And I walk through that mausoleum, and there are Williams, there are Smiths, there are Jones, several of them. And I walk through the cemetery, and that's the only McCracken in the cemetery. And it just kind of jumps out at me every time I go there. And it's a sobering reminder. It's a sobering reminder that I'm going to die. I will die. And my wife's going to die. And my kids will die. And you're going to die. Isn't that great that you came Easter morning and I'm telling you you're going to die? You know, just want to give you some good vibes this morning. But you're going to die. And that's why this day, Easter, is so important. Because Easter is hope for eternity. It's hope beyond the grave. It's hope that stares death in the face and says, you can say to it, even though I don't like you and I'm not looking forward to experiencing you, you don't scare me. You don't scare me because Jesus Christ has kicked the end out of the tomb and he's made it a tunnel. From life to life. And the reality of the resurrection gives us unexpected hope to face the fear of death. Now, my hope stems from the fact, from the words that Jesus said at the grave of a person that he dearly cared for. His name was Lazarus. And he spoke it to the same Mary that ran to the tomb. He says in John 11, verses 25 and 26, that says this, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. And then Jesus asked Mary this, do you believe this? Do you believe this? Do you? Do you believe that? People say to me, sorry you lost your mom. Sorry you lost your dad. And I'd say, you know, I didn't lose him. I know exactly where he is. Peace shelled out. He went home with God. And he's not in the mausoleum. And very soon, I'm going to find him. Very soon, I'm going to be with him because I believe this. I believe it when Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life, and whoever believes in me, even though he dies, will live. He will live. Recently, Tree and I saw the movie Paul the Apostle. It's on right now. It's a story really of kind of a dramatic way showing how Luke comes to encourage Paul in prison, Rome, his second time in there. And I read an interview from Jim Caviezel. If you remember, Jim Caviezel played Jesus in the Passion. How many of you saw The Passion? Yeah, most everybody. And they asked him which was more difficult to play, Luke or Jesus. And he said, well, Jesus was a challenging role for me. He said, I practice, though, by getting up in the morning, and I go out in my backyard and walk across my swimming pool and practice walking on the water. Funny deal. So, but in the movie, they have this Roman general whose daughter is dying of a strange disease. And there are lots of talks between Paul and the Roman general, Paul and Luke, throughout the movie. Basically, Paul tells his life story. But the general is desperate for his daughter, and Luke goes and tends to the daughter. Before that, he was in the Colosseum waiting for the next day for a whole group of Christians. This was during the time of Nero, whenever he would put Christians on fire to light the walkways in Rome, and would put them in the Colosseum so that the wild animals could just destroy them for fun. It's called a circus. And they take Luke in the movie out of the Colosseum, and he goes back to tend to the general's daughter. And the general's daughter lives during that time. And Paul is talking to the general, and he says to him, the general says to Paul, he said, I want to thank you for your concern for my family. My wife thanks you. My daughter lives. He said, I'm sorry for the deaths of your friends yesterday at the circus. He said, I couldn't do anything about that. And he said, I know it may make you sad. And Paul nods his acknowledgement. And he says, how can you still believe? How can you still believe when there's death, when there is senseless death like this? And Paul says to the general, he says, have you ever been sailing? The general says, yes, I was stationed in such and such place during such and such war. And Paul says, you know, you look out from the boat and all you see is this vast sea. And it becomes calm, and sometimes you lean over the side of the boat and you scoop up the water and you hold that water in your hand. But he said, you know, that water always leaks out, never stays. You take the seawater, there's plenty of it there, and you hold it, but that leaks out. And Paul says, that's like our life. From the moment we are born, it's leaking out. It's no longer there. And it happens in just a short amount of time. All of us live a short amount of time. But Paul says, for those of us who follow Christ, our attention is not just on the shortness of our life, but it's the vastness of the sea. It's beyond that. We serve a God in which we focus on the vastness of his kingdom, that there's more to this life than just the brief time that it leaks through our fingers. And the Roman general looks at him and he says, you really believe there's something more than this life? And Paul says, that's what I live for. He says the thing that becomes in Philippians, he says, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. There's more to this life than just this life. In fact, the vastness of this life overwhelms the small time where it leaks through our fingertips. There's more to it than that. Later, Paul and Luke are walking along, and Luke said, I heard from the garden window in the general's house the cheers going up in the Colosseum where many of our brothers and sisters died yesterday. And Paul nods and he said, yes, but the trumpets were louder when they stepped into heaven for eternity. Friends, that's why the resurrection can take our fears and blend them into hope. We can find unexpected hope in graveyards because there is more than just this life. And I know we're all about wanting to have justice in this life and wanting to have this and that in this life and power in this life, but it's gone in a moment while eternity stretches out before us. And our hope lies not in this life, in the power of the one who can change death into life. Amen? That is the ultimate joke that God played on Satan on Resurrection Day. And friends, you can come out of the shadow of grief, you can come out of the shadow of fear, and walk into the sunlight of the resurrection and have hope if you'll really, I don't mean just intellectually, but you'll stake your life on the resurrection being true. Would you pray with me? Father, I'm so grateful for this grand event that we call Easter. This event, Father, that goes beyond space and time. Father, I am so thankful that that there is resurrection hope, that there is resurrection power, and for the reality of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Father, our world needs a Savior and is looking for one. So, Father, would you send us out from this building today as people who live with hope, people who spread it, people who are filled with the love of another kind, people who spill that love over into other people's lives, into so many love-starved families and colleagues and neighbors and friends. We pray this prayer in the name of the resurrected one, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Friends, resurrection is promise of life. It's a promise that goes beyond this life right now. I love Revelation chapter 21, verse 4, which talks about what heaven is. You realize in heaven, there is no car bombs? You realize in heaven there's no racial killings? You realize in heaven that God will wipe away every tear from our eyes? You realize in heaven that our knees, some of us this morning, my knees are killing me this morning, I don't know why, but do you realize that when we get to heaven, there's no need for artificial knees? Amen, amen, amen. There's no pain, there's no sorrow, there's no tears. He'll wipe away every tear from our eyes. That's what we have to look forward to. And it's not just in a little world that passes through our fingertips. It's something more and substantial. If you have never accepted the resurrected one as your Savior, the leader of your life, and the forgiver, we invite you to come this morning as we stand and sing.